Let's start with the basics for the audience that might just be tuning in for the first time, wondering where we are. Rocket Lab is an end-to-end space provider, space launch services systems provider. Bring us up to speed on what that means.
Yeah, we think that the space companies of the future are ones that aren't just a launch company or just a satellite company or just an operator of satellites. It's really all about providing an end-to-end service. So what you're seeing here in Long Beach is really our headquarters. We make a lot of the rocket components here, rocket engines, the avionics and so forth. So we have a pretty big footprint here in Southern California, but we've since expanded that. And of course, the company got started in New Zealand, but then expanded to the US and starting to expand further throughout the United States, including locations in places like Denver and Albuquerque and Stennis, Mississippi and Silver Springs, Maryland. And of course, a launch site in Wallops Island, Virginia, and a facility in Toronto, Canada as well. So we've established ourselves a very broad footprint, doing much more than just launch.
An HQ here in SoCal, which fits exactly what we're talking about. Two launch systems, what are they and what are the differences?
Right, so the vehicle you see behind you is Electron. And Electron is the second most frequently launched vehicle in the United States. It's launched 53 times. So we've got a significant lead in the small dedicated launch market.
Okay.
And we're developing a second vehicle, which is called Neutron, which will address the larger medium class launch market.
Can we dig into the practicalities and how difficult space engineering is? Where are we with Neutron and what are some of the issues and the steps of getting it up and running?
Yeah, well, we're quite a ways along the path of Neutron. Yeah, so we've been at it now for a little over 3 years. We announced the program when we came public in August of 2021. It's amazing to see a rocket program come together. You know, I hadn't come from a space background before joining the company about 6.5 years ago. And just to see what it takes to pull together and pull off a rocket development program is absolutely staggering. The complexity, not just from just
It's literally rocket science, Adam. You can say it.
It is literally rocket science. I'm grateful every day that there's people who have dedicated their lives to developing these complex systems that are absolutely amazing. So it's a very, it's a very detailed, very arduous task to get there. And I think that's what's so exciting from a business perspective is the fact that if you can do it, you're one of a few numbers of organizations in the history that have actually pulled it off. And so it creates a very defensible position because, again, space is very, very hard. And, we have the challenge of waking up every morning and doing battle with physics, but also doing battle with some of the most fierce competitors on the planet, including SpaceX. And so we look around our industry and we see bodies everywhere that we have to step over.
Wow.
And, it kind of makes you wake up every morning and kind of like, okay, this is a serious business. We got to make sure that we make all the right decisions, be very efficient with our capital, and very, very focused on execution.
I mean, you are the numbers guy. Let's just talk about capital efficiency.
Sure.
You have to spend an extraordinary amount of money. You took this company public. You're having to answer to a whole host of retail investors and more increasingly institutional investors. Mm-hmm. What's the revenue run rate and where is the money coming from?
Yeah, we're very fortunate that we've been able to get now to a scale. So Q2, we generated over $100 million in revenue. Mm-hmm. So we really kind of now crossed that threshold of scalability. We've shown that a model can scale. I think it's very important that we've done it not just on launch, because launch represents about 30% of our revenues. Space systems actually represent 70%.
Mm-hmm. And just on that, when you say space systems is 70% of revenue,
yeah,
just in layman's terms, what are you talking about?
So we sell a variety of solutions. So we sell subsystems into the merchant market. So we sell things like solar solutions for spacecraft. We sell radios and battery systems and composites and so forth. So we really are very serious in material to the merchant subsystem market. But then we also build full spacecraft solutions. So for example, we built full spacecraft for NASA. In fact, we built a couple spacecraft that are going to be orbiting Mars in the not too distant future.
Yes, this is big news for you recently.
Very big.
Because you weren't on that list, and now you are.
Well, that's actually for the Mars sample return.
Okay, sample return.
Yeah, and you're right. We were not included in the first, but we were ultimately added to that program, so that's very exciting. But when you look at all the different programs that we're across, not just subsystems, but we're actually making full satellites for, including the Defense Department and their Space Development Agency. We want a contract to be the prime contractor for over $500 million contract. So it's actually the one thing that's most exciting for me is how quickly we've come from a very organic base to now building a very significant size revenue and getting, again, past that $100 million threshold per quarter.
And you talk about the Electron behind us, 53 mm-hmm. already put into space. How many launches are we looking at in terms of the next year? What sort of cadence are you trying to live up to?
Well, we've indicated 15 to 18 launches this year. We've launched 11 times so far, so we've got a big Q4 coming up. And then when you look at the kind of rate going to next year, we see growth off of that. And a lot of it's really not dependent on how many rockets we can build. We can build a lot of rockets. Mm-hmm. We could build almost, we've kind of sized ourselves.
You're
to build,
3D printing a whole load of it.
We're 3D printing a lot of stuff here. We could build
So what is the limiting factor?
it's really the market at this point. It's really the market. We could build as many rockets as the market demands, but it's a new market. It's a nascent market, and I think, you know, it just takes time for these markets to develop.
I want to get into this, the business of space, and just bear with me, Caro. Elon Musk,
I bear with you a lot,
has a big gap right over you, a big sort of lead with SpaceX, and he talks about this idea that the business of sending payload to orbit tops out for them at $3 billion. Mm. Now, that's a scale that you're not near yet, but it makes it seem like there's a cap, there's a ceiling on how much money you can ever make in this business. What do you make of that?
I think it depends on how you define this business, right? I think, yeah, even as we've seen with SpaceX, I don't think they stopped at just launch. So launch is a very critical part of the ecosystem, but it's not the biggest piece of the ecosystem. So the applications and creating that ongoing revenue stream from applications of having a constellation in orbit, that is really what people are shooting for as far as where the real scale for this industry comes from. And that's exactly what we're oriented around. We're all about being an end-to-end space company where we can design the spacecraft. We can build the spacecraft in a very vertically integrated way with our own subsystems. We can launch them on a variety of rockets, and we can operate those in orbit. So it's a very, very important thing to think about yourself as an end-to-end player, because again, if you're a bespoke kind of one solution provider, it's probably not the path to survivability.
For those institutional investors sat watching, and indeed retail investors who are excited about putting money into rockets.
Very excited.
Tell us about how the market scales up. What is needed? You're saying you can get these, you can build these as quickly as the market wants. Right. Well, what gets the market to the next iteration, to the size that you want to be able to serve it at?
I think the most exciting thing about what's going on in this market right now is that you think about what typically drives the hockey stick growth, kind of characteristic of an industry, and it's usually commercial. But I think we're in a really interesting period where we're actually seeing the hockey stick being derived not only from commercial opportunities. So everyone's seen what SpaceX is doing with Starlink, so that's kind of old news to a certain extent. But then you see Amazon Kuiper, you see Telesat Lightspeed, you see the SDA constellation. So you're actually seeing a combination of government and commercial all presenting hockey stick opportunities, and that's really it's not a one bet kind of situation right now. There's lots of different irons you can put your fire into.
Adam, there's so much more to come, as you know, in this hour. But before we let you go, a word for SpaceX, what they enabled your company to do, particularly here in California.
Like, I think you have to give them amazing credit for what they've accomplished. They really kind of are, an inspiration and aspirational target as well. Like, we've seen that what can be done, right? And I think that's the one thing is we wake up every morning understanding the challenge that faces us, but we're not intimidated by it. That's one thing that this company does not ever get, is intimidated by competition, whether it's SpaceX or anybody else. So we're up for the challenge. It's exciting, and there's a tremendous amount of opportunity, and I think we're in a great position to exploit it.